It's always nice to collaborate with him and talk to you. I'll start my presentation by which will be focused on virtual patients and let you know how much work we have been doing throughout the years on this front. I hope this will work. Okay. So let me start with a little bit of a slide that shows that some of the odd things that happened today in the world, like the, I'll just take Skype as one of the things that we have been using right now. It's one of the largest phone companies, but if you have no telecom infrastructure, and like Facebook, it owns no media, but it's the no content, but it's the most popular media owner. Perhaps if we take such an analogy, we can perhaps think of what is in for medical education technology, and what does that mean if, when you come to how health education is supported by technology, or the notion of virtual patients in health education. Perhaps we can discuss the similar thing that we could be providing the most expensive and the most contemporary health education, but without you know, actual content or infrastructure sometimes in our hands. But that would be a challenge, of course. So obviously, when you come to the medical education of practice, is the fact is that half of the things that we teach is obsolete in 10 years' time. Now it's been even less than 10 years. And we, the teachers of medical students, do not know which half is the wrong one. So there is a challenge there. And there is a lot that will depend on empirical evidence, experiential evidence, the patient values and preferences and things like this, especially when it comes to medical decision making. So I'll just go through a little bit of these trends and taboos, but also then focus on what we have achieved so far and what is shaped as a shifting paradigm of the use of virtual patients in medical education. Medicine has a reputation of a conservative discipline, and this is not due to the disciplinary content, but due to how learning and teaching is supported. We still use big lecture theaters for where there's no interaction when you present stuff, and end of semester exams, so summative assessments basically. There are hierarchical models of operation that prevent effective mechanisms of interactions and exchange of knowledge between experts and learners. And there is a lack of links with the healthcare professional communities of practice, basically, when it comes to the medical students or to the health learners in practice itself themselves. There is also a hidden curriculum. People don't only learn from the, what we teach and what they study, but also learn on the way, with other ways, with attitudes, with technologies and clinical encounters, etc. If I can just borrow some of the evidences that have been collected throughout my students, and this is in Greek, but I'll just translate it briefly. Okay, we ask them how much they know to do in the third year, and we list a few items on an agenda of clinical skills. So they just tick yes or no in each of the clinical skills. So this question that you have in front of you, the table, says, if you said a yes in that question, where do you get the medical knowledge from and the skills from? And the answer is very to, you know, due to personal interest and, work on the health center, etc., and the personal interest that I've been asking. Or due to my fellow students, or due to my relatives. For instance, my father is a doctor. Or due to external books like things that I've learned in high school and Facebook and all kinds of things in the same, other people from my country back with, and they are doctors, etc., etc. So you do understand that this is not a theoretical predicate, that there is a hidden curriculum, but it's a fact that there is a hidden curriculum when it comes to healthcare practice, in fact, like the medical degree, etc. And much of this depends nowadays on alternative educational experiences, where can we do come into scenario-based learning and inquiry-based learning. And this is driven by a move towards more student-centered learning and a stronger link between teaching and disciplinary research, for instance. That's why we have been discussing during the conference that we dedicate in this field, which we started back in 2012. But last year we had a conference like this on medical and health education informatics, which we discussed more and more much of these things and the technologies underneath or within involved in these issues. And we changed the medical education informatics domain, which initially started longer ago with different workshops, etc. Between 2009 and 2012, we had a European project which was called Medicator, and we developed technologies and platforms to share and prepare for content, medical and health education content. We introduced the notions of repurposing and the standards to support the repurposing actions of educational content. And we gave a lot of emphasis on technical aspects of semantics and social media, etc., and providing the missing semantics bit from the natural patient's front. If I would like to share with you the video of that presentation, just a little bit.
Semantic web, as a consequence, one interface such features so as from
I'll just stop it to save some time, go back to the presentation. So I'll just concentrate on the scenario-based learning and perpetual education, which was one of the technologies and pedagogic paradigms that we have used in the NetGator project as well. But let me say that contemporary activities are usually fueled by the fact that if we understand that our abilities to measure what we do and how we think are poor, and therefore we understand that not all things are possible in education. Now, let me go into sharing with you a few thoughts on if we develop a specific technology, what is it in over time? How is it accepted and visible? But at the moment, when you introduce a new idea, the time is zero, and then immediately you start visualizing it, and there's a hype, and there's a hope, and that goes to a maximum after a certain limited time period. But then there is a lot of disillusionment, and this happens in most of the technology being applied in education as well, and other, of course, domains. But then suddenly you start pushing for it, you can get a reappraisal, and eventually you can come into the productivity phase where the things that you have initially imagined that could be potentially useful can be productive as well. And we are just hitting the era of productivity with these. Virtual patients and scenario-based learning, if you consider the continuum of competencies, become essential when you have to do clinical reasoning, teaching, the process of taking history and exams, and the process of working in teams or teaching high-risk students, medical students. And especially in the first bit, when you have the clinical reasoning, we have practiced it a lot throughout the number of years. Initially, we have been using the open labyrinth system of the University of St. John's University of London, where we have to sort of, I think this is not working properly, so I'll skip it. So let me show you how the thing is at the moment in our lab. We have installed the virtual patients server. It's based on Open Labyrinth, so people can log in there, presumably their students, and then they can choose from a number of patients that we have for virtual patient encounters. So we have a full pool at the moment in our university. These have been developed by staff, academic staff members. That's why you see the photos in the left. If you choose one of them, you can run, play it, basically. And usually, this is the appearance it will receive. I'll just stop it here. This is in Greek, but you can understand the notion behind. This is where someone describes the case. And at the bottom part, there are choices. So the case asks you one critical question at the end, and you have to choose each one of these. And in the right-hand side here, you can see a timer. Sometimes the whole case is timed to last a number of minutes, or a number of seconds, or a number of hours if it's to produce. And that one could be also time to be a relevant number, like how much time you need actually to resolve these, so that it's not life critical. And then depending on what choice you make from the bottom part, you are driven into another sort of dialogue screen where another part of the case is deployed to you. Again, you have to make choices, and given the choices, you have reached another place. And this is like a tree with different branches. So the more complicated the tree, the more complicated the case can be, etc. So this is how these are now circulated, are placed in our case. And we have also tried in the past simulating these cases with games. And some of these games, if this runs, I can share it with you. You can now see how to teach a case, how to examine a patient, etc. But with the use of avatars, we choose a level. And then the patient comes in, sits down, you touch him or her, and you choose what to do first. Usually we take a history, and then the dialogue and the options that appear every time in front of you are relevant to the case that you have to examine. And the choices, again, are like in the previous case, choices that drive you through the scenario, to the different branches of the tree, basically. But you understand that here is a different sort of graphical deployment of the scenario. Still the same purpose. The purpose is to teach how to take history of a specific specialty, for instance, or how to deploy practical skills learning to students, how to take this or how to do that, etc., etc. I'll just stop it to save some more time. The same thing can be driven if you have a good course through more virtual scenarios. I'll just share with you a scenario where some of these cases, and some of these cases might be more relevant to US, I will explain in a moment. This is a Second Life environment. We can do the same thing in other more sort of environments that are more open and available nowadays. This is an environment where we want to teach skills about how to take care, to provide care to elderly people. So we have care providers of elderly people, and we want to provide them equip them with skills of everyday practice, everyday care, basically, to senior people. And we have now queued the previous example of the virtual patient, which you can see here on the right-hand side as a dialogue developing. But at the same time, we have enriched the environment by the ability to touch things. So if you want to make a phone, you can just touch the phone and make a phone call. If you want to open the window, you can open the window. If you want to touch the patient or do something, etc., etc. So it's a kind of a virtual scenario where the virtual case runs here as a text-based, and then you can interact in a rich way with the environment as well. I'll just let it go a little bit so that you can appreciate. It looks like this is on the right-hand side, the scenario now, the narrative. And you can also interact with things like if you touch the phone, you can open the phone call and say, who do you want to call? And you can call your daughter, or you can call your wife or whatever. And you can make the phone call and then you make a dialogue to appear to respond to the dialogue over the phone, etc., etc. And you can still make choices or go around, and you understand that this is facilitated so it can provide skills of everyday living with the patient, like an elderly. If I can just go on, I say the future lies in what we do with this, but before saying much about this, I have to define what is this term, learning analytics, basically. It's a recently coined term, which basically provides us the way to look into what's happening behind the scenes in a way. So if we want the learners to interact with this environment, and we keep a note and the log of what is happening during this interaction, this would be called a learning analytics, because it is emphasizing on all analytical data of the learning process. Now, I told you that we have trees of cases like before, but different parts, like the ones you see here on the left hand side, are followed by different learners. Some of them can follow the big, the long red one, or the short red one, or the yellow one, etc. These are different learning paths, basically. The way that they choose these create a number of learning analytical data, as I said. Studying these